Here's a property of fluids almost all of you can relate to, all right? So do a thought experiment with me. You're holding a little hose, okay? And here's the hose, and like the water is just kind of falling out as water does from a hose, okay? Now imagine that you take your thumb and you cover up the hole of the hose, and you're only leaving just a little bit of space left for the water to go through. What happens? All of you know, right? The water starts spraying out at a much higher velocity, and you have this much more fierce stream that goes longer, right? What's happening there? Why does that happen? Why does just covering the hole seem to give the water a greater velocity? Okay? To understand this question, we need to look at something called the continuity equation. And really, the continuity equation just comes from the simple property of conservation of matter, right? You can't suddenly create new matter, and you can't suddenly make matter disappear, okay? Now, how does conservation of matter relate to this little question of the hose? I'm gonna show you. So imagine you have a large diameter pipe like this, okay? And imagine then it tapers off to a smaller diameter pipe, okay? Like this. Now, you have water flowing through here. Okay, and now imagine that there's some imaginary line that separates the two, right? The large diameter from the small diameter, okay? So here's what we know. The volume per unit time passing through this little dotted line must be constant, okay? Because if the volume per unit time that was passing through that line somehow changed, right? If a greater volume was entering than was leaving that line, what does that mean? It means that either matter was suddenly appearing there, right? That wasn't there before, or it was disappearing into some other dimension, right? Neither of which can be true, both of which would violate conservation of matter, okay? So what that means is that the volume per unit time of a flow of a fluid must be constant, right? Unless you're somehow adding water or subtracting water away from it. But if it's a closed system, this has to be constant, okay? So what does that mean? Well, let's imagine this is side one and this is side two, okay? That means that the volume per unit time on side T, right, that's passing any given point must equal the volume per unit time on side two, okay? So what do I mean by that? Let's try to visualize a volume, right? So here's like a certain volume of water flowing on this side, right? As you can see from this slide here, I'm basically gonna draw a similar picture to what's on the continuity equation slide. So imagine this is a certain volume, right, of water in this like little, it's basically like a little cylinder of water right there. Now, there's going to be some area here, a circular area. We'll call that area one, right? And there's going to be some width to it. We're going to call that area, or we're going to call that x1, okay? So the volume is the area times the height of a cylinder, right? So that's going to be a1 x1 over t, right? Okay, now over here, since the area is going to be smaller on this side, right? Then it's going to take a longer x2 to make up as much volume of water as there is in this thinner sliver of volume over here, right? So this, if this guy enters and passes this line, then to be consistent with the same amount of volume, this has to be longer, right? So right here we have v1, this is going to be v2, right, where I'm talking about volumes. And here we go. This is these two volumes here, V1 must equal V2. Okay? That's the conservation of matter part. So that means that there's going to be a smaller A2 here. So this is going to be A2 times X2 over T. Okay, so check this out. This distance, this linear distance divided by time, that's just a velocity. So we can replace X1 over T with just the velocity at which the fluid is flowing, right? So A1, V1 is going to equal A2, V2, this here just becomes V1, and this here becomes V2. But what does that mean? That means that if I were to take this little relationship, which, by the way, is called the continuity equation. If I were to take this relationship and solve for the velocity on the 2 side, right? So I'm solving for V2, right? That's going to wind up being that V2 equals A1 V1 over A2, right? So here's the thing. What happens if I increase A1, right? A1 gets big and A2 becomes small. What happens to the second velocity? That must increase, okay? So this tells you that if I go from a big area to a small area, in order to keep this relationship, okay, that means that the velocity on the second side, the V2 side, must increase. That is why when we cover up the hose, right, we see the water passing by much faster, have a much faster velocity, because in order for the same amount of volume to be moving, it has to be going so much faster to get that much volume past this point. Okay? I hope that intuitively makes sense. If you have a large area, the water can just meander slowly and you have a certain amount of volume passing per unit time. But if you suddenly constrict that area, you got to get the same amount of fluid, right? It's the same volume of fluid in the same amount of time, but with much less area, so it's got to haul. It's got to go much, much faster, okay? So this is the continuity equation, and this is a property that governs the flow of all fluids all the time, okay? One thing I want to be careful, one thing that's a little bit confusing here, is that here, these Vs are volumes, right? It's a volume of water, and here, once we get to this point, these are actually velocities, right? So I'm replacing volume by A times X, but X over T are velocity, so don't get confused. This is volume. And this over here is velocity. Okay? Now, this has a lot of implications for health and life sciences because, I mean, basically, our veins and arteries are a bunch of pipes like this, right? And so if you start constricting them, you know, if a certain amount of buildup starts to happen in those arteries, your blood is going to be flowing much faster, right? It's going to be more stress on the body. So let's take a look at it. You can look at this next slide. This is why should a life scientist care about this, okay? So it says coronary artery disease is the blockage of arteries due to the deposits of fat building up. Blood flows through a standard blood vessel at about 1.7 meters per second. Let's say that Bob the Blob came up to live with humans and automatically started eating Carl's Jr. every day. Sorry, I crack myself up sometimes. Causing his blood vessels to be 43% blocked. What would be the speed of blood flow in Bob's partially blocked blood vessels? Okay. So, guys, we could just use the continuity equation to solve this very easily. Okay? Let's do it. Continuity equation, we know, is just A1 V1 equals A2 V2, right? So let's suppose in a normal artery, A1 is the full area of an artery. We'll just call it A1, right? But we know that A2, so it's 43% blocked, which means that that's going to be 57% open. So A2 is just going to be 0.57 times the original A1. Right? So we can automatically replace A2 with that, okay? So in other words, we have A1 V1 equals 0.57 A1 V2, okay? That cancels out with that. Those are both the same area. V1, as it says, like in a normal standard flowing artery, it's going to be 1.7 meters per second, okay? Times 0.57 V2, right? Divide both sides by 0.57. I get that the new velocity in this partially clogged artery is going to be 5.23 meters per second. So you see, by even having a partially clogged artery, the speed of the blood flow in that artery goes from 1.7 to 5.23 meters per second. I am not a clinically trained doctor, but I'm guessing that's probably not healthy.